Okay, good morning everyone. I hope that you all had sweet dreams about projections and datums. And of course, to start with, we have a nice projection here, the logo of Marine Regions. I just want to say, if you still have questions about the tasks about yesterday, Britt told me that she will come here just before coffee break. So if you have any remaining questions, she will come here and will. I think she will explain something about one exercise where there were some problems. But she will come here, and so if you have questions, you can still ask them. Okay, so now I will talk a bit about marine regions in this first session. I will first give a presentation, and then at the end there are two tasks on the course, but they are like more open questions, so it's for you to discover the website and then you can fill in some answers. So I will start first with the presentation. So what is marineregions.org? Well, it's a website that we developed. It's also a database, and it actually consists of two big things. And that is, first of all, it's a list, a database of marine georeferenced place names. So actually an atlas of a lot of marine names. That is, and such a thing, such a database is also called a gazetteer. And we also provide a lot of maritime boundary products. So these are the two main things in marineregions.org. We developed it since, I don't know, I think since 2005 or so, here at the Flanders Marine Institute. So it's actually, since then, it's a bit growing and growing. The purpose, the main or the first purpose of it was that it serves our big biogeographic databases. I will explain this later in the presentation. So in this presentation, I will first talk about the gazetteer, so the database of marine place names. Then I will talk about the boundary products, the maritime boundary products. Maybe that is maybe most interesting for you for this course. But actually, everything is interesting. And then I will say something about our users. Okay. Yeah. But first of all, the gazetteer. So here you see a world map. Does anyone has an idea about the projection of this world map? I mentioned it yesterday. Yes, it's the Robinson projection. So, but it actually, it are also, you can see some outlines of the countries, but it are actually also all dots of points of records from the marine regions gazetteer. So every dot represents a point in our database, a record in our database. And we have, so you see that we have acquired a global coverage. So in our database, we integrate also different other gazetteers. Some are global, for example, the GEPCO. I don't know if you heard about GEPCO. It's the General Bathymetric Chart of the Ocean. So they want to map the whole ocean floor. I think they want to map the whole ocean floor by 2030 or so in a very high resolution. And they also main like a global gazetteer of marine underwater features. ArcGIS is another one. We also have regional gazetteers in our database. For example, Antarctica has its own database of place names that is called SCAR. And you can see, for example, all the points here around Antarctica. But we also include that gazetteer into our own data gazetteer. And for example, we also have the Black Sea. We started since last year to also include national gazetteers, for example, New Zealand and Canada. And that are mainly the countries where we have a lot of contact with, that they want to ask, hey, can you include this or database also in your database? And then we do it. But that doesn't want to say that we won't include other countries into our database. We also have thematic gazetteers, for example, the Natura 2000 areas that are, I think, European nature areas or UNESCO marine heritage sites. We have several fishing zones, fishing delineations, for example, the ICES and FAO fishing zones. And we have the maritime boundaries, and I will talk more about this later in the presentation. And another example is that we also have, for example, ecological classifications. If there's an important paper that delineates important ecological zones, then we also try to include all these relevant information into our database. I've seen that yesterday you already had this slide, so you already had an introduction about marine regions. Is that correct? So, and actually what I saw is that it has already 28,000 place names. That was a slide from yesterday, but this is actually a slide from 2013. So yesterday on the website, this is from yesterday, so actually we increased quite a lot. So now we have over 57,000 places. So there's a steady increase since 2005. And as I said, we have now quite a lot of records. So how is a database structured? So what parameters or what features does a record have, or what information does a record have? Well, first of all, it has the coordinates in latitude and longitude. And of course, you have to provide the geographical reference system, so it's in WGS84. It has a unique identifier. We call that an MRG ID, and it's actually a marine regions geo object ID, and it's just to uniquely identify each geo object or each record. The objects also have a hierarchy, and I will explain it later. So it has the hierarchy. And it consists also out of place types. So a place type is, for example, a country. That can be a place type. Or a seamount. That is also a place type. Is that actually a type or a category for our records? And it also has a lot of synonyms attached to one specific name. So for example, for Belgium, we have quite a lot of synonyms. So we also try to include a lot of synonyms. So just to explain you a bit the relations that we have, for example, these are the sandbanks in front of the Belgian coast, just at sea. And they have it's called Flemish banks, and they have this MRG ID, this unique identifier. And these Flemish banks, they're actually partly into the Belgian exclusive economic zone. So in the database, we then mention, okay, the Flemish banks is partly part of the Belgian exclusive economic zone. And also the Flemish banks will be partly part of the French exclusive economic zone. So this is one kind of a relation. And then this Belgian exclusive economic zone is of course also part of the North Sea. So we also have this relation into our database. So actually it's a whole structured database. And these are just to mention it, the different relations that we have. For example, for some geological features, we also have other relations, for example, that one particular ocean current influence, for example, a geological deposit, just to say an example. So this whole database is quite structured, and you can just browse to all this structure in the website. So the main website is Marine Regions, and if you can then go to Gazetteer and browse, you can actually just click through and navigate to different countries. And you can actually also go to your own country and check if the hierarchy that we mentioned there is correct. So that is actually the first task, just to go to the website, just browse to the website, go to the hierarchy and see if you have, if there are any errors that you find, and if so, you can let us know. This exercise is mentioned on the website, but I will now go through the presentation, and afterwards you have time to do these exercises, okay? So the main exercise is just that you can check the website. You don't have to fill in a lot. It's just if you find something that seems wrong, you can fill it in. If you think everything is okay, you can just mention, okay, everything seems okay. If you have any other questions, like later next week, in 2 months, you can always contact us at this email address. So the second part is the maritime boundaries. So we also provide several products of maritime boundaries. For example, the FAO fishing areas. So that is a shapefile that you can download on our website. It's freely available for everyone to use. So you are free to download and use it. We also have the IHOC areas. And actually, these sea areas, we developed this product based on an old document. It's called Limits of the Oceans and the Seas, published by the IHO in 1953. But this is currently the most recent version of this document. We know that they are working on a new updated version, but it is currently not published yet. So actually, this document, it's a document with coordinates where they say, okay, the South Atlantic Ocean goes from this to this coordinate. And actually what we did is we put all these coordinates, we made shapefiles out of it, and then we made these products of the different sea areas. Then we have the maritime boundaries, and the product, the maritime boundaries, is actually what we call this, the maritime boundaries. And it are actually the different zones defined by the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. I think if you work in the maritime sector or you work with the coastal development, then I think most of you have heard about it. Who has heard about the Convention on the Law of the Sea? Most of you? Okay, that's very good. So actually, what was it? In 1982, a lot of countries and the United Nations agreed on some principles to protect the coastal zones or the seas. And they defined several zones. So for example, all of them, most of them you can see here. So first of all, you have internal waters, as you can see here. And that is actually, if your coastline is really rugged or irregular, then a country can provide a straight baseline. And inside this baseline, or more landward of this baseline, that is what they call internal waters. You also have archipelagic waters. For example, here, if you have an archipelago, then you can also, countries can also make baselines around these islands to provide an archipelagic baseline, and inside here you have the archipelagic waters. It's another kind of baseline. Then from these baselines, or the normal coastline, what is a normal baseline, or the straight baseline, or the archipelagic baseline, they calculate a 12 nautical mile zone, and these areas are called the territorial seas. And actually all these different zones, what is important, that they have different rights. So for example, the territorial seas, in this area, actually at each country or each state can impose its own rules. That's just an example, but there are several rules or different regulations for each zone, and that is described in this long agreement, the UNCLOS, Law of the Sea. There is 12 nautical miles. You also have contiguous zones. There is 24 nautical miles, as you can see here. And you also have the exclusive economic zones, that is 200 nautical miles. For example, in these zones, I think each country has the right to exploit the natural resources in that area. We also have joint regimes, and I will explain that in this special kind of EEZ, and I will explain it on the next slide. So that are the different zones, and I want to mention everything is all actually based on treaties between different countries, or actually coordinates out of treaties from the countries provide to the United Nations. And what they usually do is they provide a list of coordinates, and what then we started to do like a long time ago is converting all these coordinates in really a product that the people can use. So we provide this data for free for people, researchers to use. We have several what we call statuses of the exclusive economic zones. So the normal EEZs are here now in a kind of blue. You also have joint regimes, for example here, and that are actually areas where two countries or more countries agree that they have a special status. And that of course depends on what they mention in the agreement, but for example it can be like between these two countries that they say, okay, our both countries have the same rights to do some fishing here. It's just an example, yes?
I have a question regarding the EEZ.
Yes?
The object, for example, for Algeria, I know that they claim the EEZ, but they didn't set the boundaries. But I see that it exists in this map. So I was wondering for countries like in Algeria, which doesn't set the boundaries, how did you do to get these maps?
Well, that's a good question. Actually, all of the treaties that are in UNCLOS, that we try to include it in our product. So, for example, we start with all the treaties, checking all the treaties, and add all the coordinates into our product. Of course, it's possible that not all of them are in our database, and it's something that is task two, that you can check your own country. And if you think that you that things are missing, that's possible. Like if something has changed, we usually take track it, but it's also possible that something has changed. Then you can always report it to us. But we only accept like the official treaties that are deposited in the United Nations repository. If there are no treaties, we usually take the median line between two countries. So actually the middle line between two countries, because that is what the UNCLOS convention more or less mentions. Okay? Well, yes, that is very sensitive. First of all, I want to mention, we don't, if you read the disclaimer on the website, we say that we don't, that our product here is not a legal document. We try to be as good as possible, but it is mainly for scientific purposes. But what do we do then? That's actually just the next point on the slide. We say, okay, there's a conflict, and we say there's an overlapping claim. So more, two or more exclusive economic zones of different country overlap, and then we mention this as an overlapping claim. And if you, one of the tasks is to browse through the website, and then you can really see that there in the world there are quite a lot of places where there still is conflict. There can be a small conflict, or that there's not a real conflict, but just two countries that say, okay, this is ours, and then another country that also says this is ours. So that's something for you that you can discover on our website in task two, I think. Okay? So, yes, you can actually browse to like this map on our website. So, we regularly update this product because, of course, sometimes there are new treaties. And I think every 2 years, more or less, we publish an update. So, in 2018, in the beginning of this year, we launched version 10. And we also included new treaties. For example, this was the last one that we included. It was a treaty from February 2018. Between Costa Rica and Nicaragua. So, for example, what we in earlier had is this red dotted line, is I think it's the median line, and then we replace it in the new product by these treaty lines. And that is just how we update our product. It's a Creative Commons license, so you can use it for all your research. And you can freely download it. We also have a web service and so on. So everybody is free to use it. But if you really have, we sometimes have questions from companies, but if you want to make some product out of it as a company, we do a case-by-case visit. So here you have the world map of the exclusive economic zones, and we also make derived product. For example, we make the intersection between the exclusive economic zones and the ISOC areas. So for example, if you have the exclusive economic zone of Colombia, we then, by doing this intersection between the ISOC area, we have, for example, the Colombian part of the Caribbean Sea and the Colombian part of the North Pacific Ocean. And that is important because the first aim or the first goal of this database was actually to, as an help, as a geographical backbone for biogeographical databases, so for species occurrences. So, and as you can see here, it's very possible that there are species here in the Colombian part of the Caribbean Sea that are not occurring on here on the Pacific Ocean. So for that we make all these actually these products. So now I'll mention some of our users just to have an idea who uses our products. So first of all, what I said, it serves as a backbone for biogeographical databases, and I will just go to this website. It's called Marine Species. And actually, it provides a list of all the different species in a marine species. And what you can do, for example, is go to distribution. And then, for example, just look for something. For example, the Belgian part of the North Sea. And this website actually uses the Marine Regions database. So then you can search. And then it will provide a list of all the species occurring here. Also the other way around. I think there are actually more than 96 species. You can, for each species, if you, for example, now this species, you can also see where it actually occurs. And again, this distribution, these areas come from the Marine Regions database. So that is one purpose or one type of users who are using the Marine Regions. Also a lot of fisheries or fisheries research use our boundaries. For example, Global Fishing Watch, they use our product to delineate as a background layer, but also to do some analysis in how much is fished inside some exclusive economic zones, how much fishing is done outside exclusive economic zones, so they are called the areas beyond national jurisdiction. But also, for example, conservation and biodiversity organizations use our data. For example, here's the Pew Trust, and they use this the exclusive economic zones just to give an idea about the high seas and the biodiversity there. For another example is the International Seabed Authority. You can see here on the map, well, it's not clear on the presentation, that they use our data. Or for example, the InterReach project for crest studies also uses our exclusive economic zones. They are not the only one. As you can see, quite a lot of people use our data. And actually, I think we are the only source or the only provider that provides this product. The exclusive economic zones is the main product in a free way. So I think most of the research that is done on fisheries and so, they mostly use our data. And you are, of course, also free to use it. And just to mention how many users we have, when we launched a new version, we sent an update to 30,000 users that were registered on our website. It was just before the GDPR regulations, so I don't think you can use it now. But only 40 of them unsubscribed, so we think we have a success ratio of more than 99%, and I think that is very good. So we launched this new version in February, and already 10,300 downloads were done of these new products. And the EEZs are the most popular, so this was already downloaded more than 6,000 times. And when we first launched it, we could really see like a spike in the downloads, so that was fun to see. Okay, that was the introduction. So the first task, as I mentioned, was about the gazetteer. So check the gazetteer, check your own country, if there are, you can see some errors. And then the second task is also that you can browse to these exclusive economic zones. You can, there you can, I can really show it. For example, this is the map interface. What you can see here now is like all the different boundaries. So, for example, the different colors represent different boundaries. And for example, if I click here on this boundary between France and Spain, and then you'd have more information here below the map. And then you see, for example, you have also a link to actually the document that describes this boundary. For example, if I click here on this document, you go to really the document or the treaty where all these coordinates are given. So not only treaties, but also other types of lines are mentioned here. So for example, this one seems to be an unsettled line between France and Spain. So even there, there are some things that are not resolved. If you click here on the exclusive economic zones, you have the map of the different exclusive economic zones. You also have, for example, here a joint regime, and then, for example, also an overlapping claim here. But as you can see, there are quite some other areas in the world where you have also like overlapping claims. So the second task is really to go into the area that you know. That can be your own country or maybe your study area or something else, the area where that you are interested in, and that you can check if the boundaries that are there are the ones that you expect. If you think that there are differences, you can always mention it in the reply form from in the task. And You can also check here in the on this link. This is actually the website of the UNCLOS convention, and there you can go through each country. For example, if I go to Europe, then you can have all the different countries here. And for example, if I click on Denmark, you see all the documents or all the treaties of the different of this country. So the second task is really to just browse to all these sources to have an idea what all exists in the world. Is that clear? So you can do that now. It's 10, it's 10:15. I think in 25 minutes Brit will also come. So if you have more questions about the task of yesterday, you can afterwards you can ask her these questions. Okay? And if you have questions meanwhile, of course you can raise your hand and I will come around.